Welcome back once again, Media Track, issue number 2. Thank you for watching us last time. With me is my senior colleague Devika Sequeira, and she's going to start off this time by talking about something from the world of sports. Actually, as young kids, we started reading the papers from the sports page first, you know, and now we are not much into it. So, Devika, please take over.
The fact is that there's a lot of talking points this week, particularly because the assembly session is on, and there's a lot of stuff that's been churning up and a lot of questions being asked. And the most recent thing is the big question mark on whether Goa can be up and running with the infrastructure for the national games. So the national games were, after a lot of postponement, they've been set for November. But the Goa Chief Minister is asking for it to be postponed to January 2020. Now, some interesting points have come up and facts have come out in the assembly, and the Times also has highlighted it quite well. The whole story starts in 2008 when Goa was supposed to host and the games, and the contract was signed. And they were supposed to be hosted in 2011. But in 2011, Goa asked it would host the games in 2014. In 2014, the infrastructure wasn't ready. So the date was shifted. And in the end, Kerala ended up hosting the games in 2015. So Goa missed its chance. In 2016, Goa blamed early assembly elections for the delay. Then comes 2017, they ask for another postponement to 2018, and that again got postponed because of parliamentary elections and etc. So 2019 was the date suggested, and it seems like it's not going to happen even this year. Now the Chief Minister's is talking about a November dateline, but the Sports Minister Asgaonkar says that it can be held in August. Whether that can happen or not is another matter. But just look at the costs involved. 140 crore, according to this report in the Herald, was obtained from the Economic Development Corporation at 11% interest per annum. So is this expenditure worth it? Are we building infrastructure that will become a white elephant again, like what happened in the other games? And so that's the Lusophonia games. Infrastructure will be used this time, but at the same time, that infrastructure wasn't used all these years. At least it wasn't used to its full, full extent.
It's a long, long story. I mean, it gives a new kind of interpretation to Goan Susega than it spoils any further.
Exactly.
But on the more serious front, it does raise issues about completion of government projects and investment priorities and duplication of infrastructure and, ability to deliver on time. Because
true.
As a society, I think these things are important, once we set the date.
Yeah. And the story starts, with the Congress government, in fact, because when the Chief Minister asked a question in the assembly, he wanted to know what happened to between 2007 and 2012, when about 82 crore was given by the centre for the infrastructure, 97.80 crore, in fact, it was. So, the question came back to the Sports Minister, Asgaonkar, who was, in fact, the Sports Minister even in 2014. So, it's like literally like a ping pong ball that's being thrown from one across. So one doesn't know really what's going on and whether we will be able to host the national games.
The other big story has been the weather and the heavy rains and the flooding in the cities that Panjim has been complaining about, other towns too. Our villages, fortunately, not so bad. But I get this feeling, Devika, that when it comes to reporting long, slow developing stories, we get kind of lost, Even we are talking about the national games, which spans out over 8-10 year period, because it's come out in the assembly, everyone can, the figures are there. Otherwise, as the media, we kind of lose track of what's happening over a long period. So even this weather extremities which we face now, flooding in many areas of Panjim, even 2-3 hours is good enough to cause a flood, which is a tough situation in that sense for people living here and all that. And the media looks at it as something immediate, like today there was flooding, today there was this damage. What about a long-term story? Because Goa is supposed to be getting affected by weather change more than other states.
True.
Coastal areas and things like that. And added to it, the drainage problem, added to it, like, you know, even I feel the Weather Bureau, which has so much equipment, sometimes gets it right, more often than not doesn't.
Yeah. And plus we have so much, you know, development going on and nobody seems to take into consideration the absolute need to look at the drainage system. Mm. And that's what's been happening in Panjim. You know, the construction happens and the drains are completely waterlogged. So it's going to get worse and worse.
One or two good comments on the social media about, you know, the cause for the waterlogging. I think Ricardo and a few others have given their own opinions of why this happens. And some of them are from a technical background, so I guess they do understand the issue, the building up in places like, you know, Miramar and mm-hmm. which were once field areas and, you know, could take the load. Yesterday, the Goa Heritage Action Group was making the same point at a press conference where they were mentioning about the loss of, you know, Ketan Nashnulkar and the loss of the drainage and things like that.
Yeah, that's absolutely a fact.
So while we are on this point, maybe the smart city connects with this.
Yeah, that is another story that's been literally, you know, resonating for days in the State Assembly. So the point here is, I think one of the reasons it has come out, of course, is the changed equations in the government, and with the new MLA of Panjim going full hog at the previous government. In fact, at the previous MLA, who was Siddharth Kunkolinkar, the previous BJP MLA, and the whole thing has come to a point where Monserrat has accused. I'm looking now at the Herald headline. It says the smart city officials have turned into an authority, and he's asking for an thorough inquiry into the functioning of the smart city project, which was developed by Imagine Panjim Smart City Development Limited, and he wants all the ongoing works reviewed according to the Times of India, and then the Times also has this report with a very good photograph which talks of Panjim crumbling but the smart city focused only on beautification. Now that's a very good point to make. But
infrastructure and roads and things like that.
One thing to be remembered in this is that Monserrat is not only the new MLA for Panjim, he also controls the municipality. And so he would definitely want a foothold into the smart city mission, which is overseeing all these new projects. And there's very little transparency so far in those projects. And there's been massive spending on it. So whether this, you know, this will bring out the figures and where the money has gone, we have to see how that will work out in this whole confrontation that's now playing out.
Another issue which came up in the assembly was this strange, unusual story which actually broke out in the social media, which was about a train full of, you know, workers, laborers, whatever we choose to call them, landing at TV station. Okay. And if you see the social media clips, they look quite unusual, because it's like, you know, one of these refugee-like situations, more recently in Europe, earlier in Bangladesh, mm-hmm. where people are just streaming out of the train. And the MLAs in the assembly raised the issue. It was telecast on the local cable channels and things like that to cover politics. And they were voicing concern that where are these people coming from, and the government asked the authorities to check out where they are coming, where they were working and all that. Agreed, the visuals look alarming, and you know, somehow sometimes social media has this ability to create you know, to create awareness, to create panic, to create fear also,
yeah.
rightly
yeah.
or wrongly. Yeah. I have very mixed feelings about it. I could be very wrong, but you know, I often end up at TV station to drop family members or whatever. And if you see a train coming there, you know, landing from anywhere, that's the normal scene. You see like a train full of people coming out, and because the bridge is like, you know, kind of very U-shaped,
yeah.
it looks like a real stream because they are walking in a single file, so it looks like a huge file coming out, okay. If you see a train leaving from TV station, you'll see a huge file going out, like, you know, but right. Of course that is a bit more staggered. So you'll feel that half of Goa is leaving Goa in that sense, or half, you know, half of Bihar is coming into Goa. Now, I don't know what is the actual, you know, truth behind the story. Sometimes you need to be careful about the development, sometimes about the media way of reporting and handling this.
Yeah. But was this incoming, you know, influx, was it recent? It happened?
This media clip was recent. It's a very recent clip. So I guess it's happening. But, you know, my point is that you can see the situation on a daily basis, both coming in and going out. Because this is a terminal station. It's almost TV or Margao is the last station. So the train almost clears out there, you know. If someone is coming to Goa, they would probably end up there.
But why would they be coming in the monsoon? What would be the reason to have such a big influx of people in the monsoon?
It's like this statistics you have about Bombay, you know, every day some half a million people enter it. Yeah. And, you know, as many are going out, though some are staying in there. And, of course, migration is an issue. And then I think it also came up because in Telangana, the new government decided to have this 75% or 80% reservation for locals.
Yeah.
That also triggered off another debate in the Goa media, particularly the video and audio-visual media, where they had discussions on it. And the point was that Goa had tried to enact this law, and I think their argument was that the governor didn't agree to it. But my understanding was that the law was passed and it was implemented because Mr. Luisinho Ferreiro's website still talks about it as an achievement, you know, in that sense.
I have a feeling that it was not really implemented. It might have been passed, but it wasn't quite implemented. And there were a lot of arguments from industry that they weren't getting the right kind of, you know, component of people with the skills they needed for their specific industry. So
the latest issue came up in the Goa University, where it was made a right. point and talking point, and about, you know, qualifications and whether you can get people with these qualifications for these posts and all. Apart from that, you know, I think domicile is a bit of a touchy and dodgy issue. It sounds like a good solution, but there are two points here. One is that certificates are very easy to get. It's not difficult to get a domicile certificate. Like, so I went to my panchayat and I said, I've been staying here for 50 years without any battering any eyelid. They gave me a 50-year domicile certificate, 50.
Okay.
And the other thing is, in a immigration-oriented state, you know, a lot of people lose their domicile because they may have migrated temporarily somewhere. That's for true. Work or somewhere, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so at one stage in our family, we were counting, and out of 8 of us, 6 were non-Goans, you know, because we were not born in Goa in that sense. So it's a very touchy issue, and I don't know whether we can solve things so simplistically. But having said that, the need to, you know, kind of tally your industry with the local aspirations
talent pool,
and talent pool, yeah, that
right.
is. So what do we next want to move to?
Yeah, so the other, you know, really big story that's playing out, and it's going to play out for a long while, is the whole agitation over the coastal zone management plan. And, you know, the minister, environment minister, Nilesh Kabral, he's given an assurance in the assembly that the fresh coastal zone management plan would be put in place after consulting all stakeholders. But it must be said, you know, for this, that Mr. Kabral faced a lot of anger when he tried to go for a meeting in Pernay, one of the stakeholders meeting in Pernay. He wasn't even allowed to come in, and there was a lot of confusion over it. But there are so many mistakes, you know, so there is this. In Navin Times, there are two reports. One talks of sand dunes, fields in Kolva, wrongly depicted in the draft coastal zone management plan. Then you have another report which talks of 600 Shandor residents who will be badly affected by if this coastal management plan goes through as it is. And you even had mention of it in an editorial in the Herald, which said that, be practical, can a new plan be prepared in a month? And that's a very valid point to raise. But in all this confusion, you know, what does the government focus on? What does the chief minister focus on? He talks of NGOs obstructing work. you know, it's the usual bogey that's being played up by politicians, that the NGOs are getting in the way of all development. So at the same time, you have this, you know, so many infrastructural projects that are just not getting completed. You can see the thing with the National Games, for instance. And yet, you know, you have this constant criticism of the NGOs, which was also done by the Goa Chamber. The point is that a lot of the cases that have been filed by NGOs in the courts have been given in their favor. If they were wrong, if they were taking the government to task for something that was not correct, they would have lost the case, right? The government would have won it. So here is a very big issue playing out, and it doesn't seem like, you know, it could get resolved anytime soon.
Interesting. Just to shift issues a bit, to go to the Bee in My Bonnet, which is the small press, I always like to look at some of the smaller publications that, you know, say unusual things. So, for example, this paper called Fudari is one of the Konkani papers which is around for last 2 years or so. These papers are not very visible because they are available in a few outlets. And okay, I wonder how many people may be aware of, you know, these kind of things, and they try to do a very valiant job in terms of getting it out, you know, maybe a couple of pages in color in the center, struggling with a lack of ads and all that, but still they keep trying, and it's interesting, like, you know, some recipes and...
What is it, a weekly or a monthly?
Yeah, it's a weekly, it's okay. A weekly, so you know, second year volume 11, and okay. Published every Monday, 12 pages, 10 rupees price, and... Okay. It's tough because if you're running a newspaper, like, you know, you need to sell it within that time frame, and distribution channels are broken down, and not everyone who wants it may know where to get it and things like that.
That's true. Plus the digital market has overtaken the media so completely. So very, you know, the chances for print to survive are getting diminished more and more by the day.
Right. People keep complaining that no one wants to pay for content, you know, and I think some papers abroad are trying different models. Some of them, like, for example, the Goa Today, which is not online.
No, it is not online.
But I can understand why they are not, no? Because a lot of their readership is expat audiences.
Yeah, but that is a very big misfortune in a sense, because somebody else has taken the name Goa Today and put it online, and it's not the same Goa Today that is in print.
No,
you know?
But here, you know, if you do, you're damned, and if you don't, you're damned. Because if you have the magazine online, then why should people buy the print?
That is true.
Having said that, you know, I found a couple of interesting reviews, book reviews here. One is by Nandakumar Kamath, where he talks about this book called Musings, done by Ashlesha Athavale, the daughter of former editor Narayan Athavale.
Yeah, yeah.
And she has come out with a book and talking about her life in Goa when she came here as a small kid in the 80s and 70s. And so you know, some of these publications do have these unusual and very kind of offbeat things which the reader of the mainstream press might not get. Yeah. This is another magazine which I came across, nothing to do with Goa.
Okay.
It's a Marathi magazine coming from Bombay, focused on food, from the Sakal group.
Okay.
Which is connected with the Gomantak Times.
That's an interesting concept.
And just 25 rupees, they managed to come out with this, a lot of ads, ad-driven. And a lot of recipes dealing with a particular theme. So this time it's on mangoes.
Okay.
And I always wonder and envy these guys for being able to produce things so inexpensively. You know? And I think that the the Indian and Chinese ability to lower cost is something which is to be valued. And the last which I'd like to raise is this magazine called Business Goa. Mm-hmm. It's the June issue, which has a cover story of Hansel Vaz.
Yeah. The man who's been doing great things with Fenny.
So they call it the Renaissance Man, not the Renaissance Man, but the Renaissance Man.
An interesting title, no doubt.
So you know, I thought it was interesting because considering that the Catholic community has so few entrepreneurs in that sense, and have now this young generation which is trying out new things. So he's trying to, you know, push Fenny. This is not an ad for drinking or alcoholism or whatever, but I think, you know, trying to revive this traditional brew and give it a new kind of image and things like that.
Yeah, that's true.
What would you like to take to next?
Yeah, now I want to bring out a story that's really of of, you know, close to the heart of people who live in Panjim.
And beyond.
Yeah, obviously, and beyond. But, you know, for people who've been born in Panjim, lived in Panjim, this is very much part of our heritage in a way. So there's this whole, you know, big controversy over Kala Academy, which the minister wants to have it demolished. So this is Culture Minister Govind Gowde, who's announced that Kala Academy's open auditorium is likely to be demolished because it's caving in, it's crumbling in all different parts. So there's been a lot of reportage on it in the Times of India. And they talked of how tarpaulin sheets have been used to protect the Kala Academy open auditorium. And it went to renovation prior to 2004, before the film festival.
The first film festival.
The first film festival, but it has been deteriorating since. And one of the problems, obviously, is leakage and seepage. The seepage comes because it's so close to the river. And it's been built on a sandy base. So the Times has a story today, that is on the 25th of July, which talks of if the Taj Mahal starts leaking, will the government demolish it? I think it's a very interesting point to make. And the Kala Academy has served not only as a center for culture and concerts and everything else, it has also brought a lot of students, architecture students, to the building. 1,000 a year visit it, because it's been designed, of course, by Charles Correa. So the whole issue hinges on, can we afford to lose a heritage structure designed by Charles Correa, and which is, you know, at the very heart of Panjim. It has been such a part of the culture of the place. At the same time, there is talk that the whole structure will come down, and the government actually intends to expand the area, which can hardly cope with the current, you know, footfalls we get there for concerts, for exhibitions, etc. So I believe
there was a lot of outrage about it because it's so iconic, and because
exactly.
Charles Correa has built it. And
exactly.
You know, and there's also a bit of questioning about whether we need to do these things, whether it's a waste of money, or, you know, whether the money would be well spent, or what are the motives and all that.
Yeah, I mean, normally one would think of restoring a heritage building. You know, you don't just bring it down and replace it with some new construction and a new design, especially when it's been built by an architect that has such a world famous architect. So how this will end, one doesn't know, but I'm quite sure that a lot of people are going to put up a lot of resistance.
The Charles Correa Foundation, which is active in Fontanes Mala, has taken up the issue, and Goa Heritage Action Group also has
exactly
voiced a concern over it. Because, you know, this attitude towards heritage is something which we could be a bit more enlightened on. No?
Oh, we have to be more enlightened on it, definitely. I mean, we just let, you know, old beautiful structures just crumble so that we can bring them down and replace it with new things. That's not the way to look at, you know, the city's character will begin to change. It has changed so much, and this will just make it worse.
I don't think people living here fully appreciate how unique Panjim is in its own way. No,
exactly.
I mean, this capital built alongside the river and the riverfront, and it has its own scenic settings and a lot of low rise, a lot of red tile roofs.
That's true.
So I think, yeah, we could be losing out on something. Anything else that you would like to bring on the table?
You wanted to talk about
some of the issues that came up in the news, this full debate over the Goa dairy,
yeah,
milk and things like that, those problems. Maybe also the Goa Miles, you know, the full controversy between Goa Miles and the private car owners. So, you know, contrary to most in the middle class, I have a slightly differing opinion on that. I know that we get overcharged by our taxi drivers, there's no doubt about it, but the fact of the matter is that they are not making huge profits themselves.
Yeah.
You know, the situation is pretty bad for them and for the customers also, and Goa Miles may not be the solution there.
Yeah.
You know, because of Goa's geography, unlike Bombay where you could get, say, a trip in a few rupees,
yeah,
here you will not get a return fare.
Yeah.
So in that sense, you know, they are caught into this reality where you have too many
Too many players, too many people have been given taxi
loans.
Licenses.
Taxi licenses, loans and things like
that. Yeah, and a lot of taxis are just idling and taking parking space. That is one big problem, especially in a city like Panjim. Because of the casinos, etc., you find a lot of the parking space has gone to taxis.
So there is a problem, no doubt. I mean, like the commuter is facing the squeeze, the taxi driver is facing the squeeze, and what is the solution that we have to find? I mean, Goa Miles is definitely not the solution. You don't get a third player and solve the problem that way. So the promise is, of course, that people will get cheaper rides, and there are people comparing, this is how much I pay a taxi and this is how much I pay Goa Miles. I mean, like that Amazon will also give you cheaper books, but at the end of the day, we don't want to finish off all bookshops in the world, you know, things like that. So.
That's true. Well, there was one really interesting story that one shouldn't overlook, and it had to do with the amount of money the Goa government has spent on the cases for the Mahadai issue, and the amount of money that has been, the Mahadai case is before the Mahadai Water Tribunal, and the whole case has cost the Goa government rupees 9 crore. But what's particularly interesting in this thing is, as the report says today, that of this 9 crore that has been spent by the government, 6 crore has gone to one advocate alone, that is Atmaram Nadkani, who earned a fee of rupees 6.39 crore from this. So, you know, this has come out in the assembly on Wednesday. And it was part of the answer given to one of the questions. But the fact is, the chief minister has now changed the advocate general, and obviously there are different political reasons for that. Even though the same government prevails, the BJP government, and Nadkani was the AG under the BJP government, and he represented the, you know, the Goa government in the case, in the Supreme Court, in other cases also. So, you know, the lawyers' fees are obviously phenomenal, and we should question it as citizens of the state.
True, yeah. You know, I mean, like, at the end of the day, we, both the citizen and the press, cannot or does not do a good job of keeping track of the big issues, like when it comes to, say, you know, is Goa financially viable? Are we entering a debt trap? Where are we spending our money?
Exactly.
So occasionally when there's a budget session, that comes up, but the number of days in which the assembly meets is very limited nowadays, unlike earlier. So,
that's,
you know,
true.
We have a huge assembly, which is bigger than the mother parliament in Britain in size. You know, I was just watching, talking about Britain, we have a new prime minister in Britain.
Yeah.
And I was just, you know, wondering how it affects the many Goans settled there.
That's going to be a question that you know, will be answered in a few months, I presume, because by October the Brexit deal has to be done.
Yeah.
And how it will affect the many Goans that have gone and settled in the UK with the Portuguese passport.
Yeah, we've got to keep that on the agenda, because, you know, it's not that it's never happened in the past, no? We've had Uganda, we've had Iraq and Kuwait and, you know, all kinds of things. So when it hits us in the face, waking up then is too late. So Boris Johnson is actually partly Turkish, apparently.
He is of Turkish ancestry.
Yeah,
he has some Turkish ancestry, and that is what makes this particularly interesting, that, you know, somebody with that kind of background is
the Empire Strikes Back, as someone was saying.
So. Is so adamant on people not, more people not coming in, immigrants coming in.
So one point I'd like to just bring to the table, there was some reports about this FDA officer who had raised the formalin case, you know, kind of getting shunted out or something.
She got shunted out, but there was another report which said the minister concerned, that is Vishwajit Rani, is actually thinking of reinstating her. So let's see how it works out.
So with that, we have run out of time. Looking forward to your views and meeting the readers in a week from now.
Okay.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.